What are some ridiculous history facts? Ancient Romans would put sandals on the hands of sleeping people, then tickle their face so they would slap themselves. At shoe root. Fun fact, this is where the idea of stiletto heels came from, monsieur. When the Romans laid siege to the Massara, a real place weirdly enough, they attempted to tunnel into the city. The Massarans released bears into the tunnels. Greater than the Massara Brain, that Wonder Woman's hometown? Yeah, it totally was. Weirdly, a lot of Greek myths tell you real locations where myths happened. And their myths about the Amazons gave them a specific real city to base them in, which later the Romans conquered. Thus, Tunnel Bear was invented. The Spartans never built a city wall, figuring that their reputation alone would mean no one would dare attack the Massara. But during the Persian War, the Persians, who had already burned Athens twice, hired a Greek guide to take them to Sparta. But when they got there, they saw a kind of crap-looking city without even a wall. They figured there was no way this place could be the mighty Sparta they had heard so much about. So they figured the Greek was lying and thus Sparta was spared. Edit. I'm remembering this from reading it in the book Persian Fire by Tom Holland. It's quite possible that I'm misremembering details or that Holland's text identifies this as a legend or story. Still, the book is a fantastic read and I heartily recommend it. This is Sparta. No, this is madness. Claudius Drusus died in AD 20 from asphyxiation when he tossed a pear in the air and caught it in his mouth. The pear tree was put on trial, found guilty of murder, and destroyed. Two important questions. 1. How large was this man's throat? 2. How small was this pear? It might not be true. Suetonius tells us this story and he lived more than 50 years after Claudius Drusus died. It's also totally possible that he was actually murdered by a man named Sejanus, who was a pretty notorious figure in the early empire. We will probably never know what really happened to High Monsieur. A lot of high-profile deaths surrounding the royal family, for lack of a better term, from around this time that have wacky stories behind them, or at least there are suspicions, and there were suspicions at the time that their deaths weren't entirely natural. Heirs to the throne under Augustus and Tiberius had a habit of dying young. In ancient Egypt, servants were smeared with honey to attract flies away from the pharaoh. Ah, God, that sounds awful. The heat, the stickiness, the buzzing all around you. That sounds like literal torture. I can't imagine. They were very healthy, with bug crawling all around the Monsieur. Ah, but they got to keep the honey by the end of the day. Something for the family to look forward to. Look, kids, dad is home. Go sick the fly honey off his body. That's so dumb. Why not just put the honey on a statue or something? I mean, you'd still need servants to carry the statue around. So just skip the middleman. I'm imagining this was for when they were out and about. The first bomb dropped on Berlin by the British during World War II claimed no human casualties, but it did kill an elephant. Never forget, there were 9 elephanta in Berlin Zoo at the start of World War II. At the end of the war, there was only one left. Its name was Sia Monsieur. Edit. Didn't expect this to blow up. I've decided not to amend my typo, you panel wolf. Edit 2. The pun was intentional. Loved reading your replies. The Battle of Bull Run, during the American Civil War, was called the Picnic Battle, because so many civilians from Washington went on picnics on the sidelines and watched. But once the battle actually started, and the Union started to get its ass kicked, they all ran away, running over injured soldiers and dead bodies and generally disrupting the battle. This was actually a relatively common thing during the Civil War. I know it happened at Gettysburg too. Fucking tourist. A Chinese emperor escaped an assassin by running around a pillar. After 2 hours, the assassin got bored and went home, and wasn't charged for his crimes. Just imagine, 20 minutes in, the assassin knows he looks ridiculous running around the same pillar this whole time. but he's kind of committed at this point. Besides, how much stamina could an emperor have? Anyway, 40 minutes in, the assassin is wondering how much time an emperor has for CrossFit each week. An hour in, the assassin still running in circles trying to catch the emperor, all the while thinking, this is so stupid. This is so goddamn stupid. He is beginning to wonder if he was given this mission as a prank. 90 minutes in, the assassin knows with horrible certainty that, whether he succeeds or fails, he's going to be the laughingstock of the whole empire. 2 hours in, both he and the emperor are still wheezing their way around the pillar. The assassin is not only tired and completely humiliated, but also realizes that he's in no shape to be able to run away after the assassination now, and figures his best bet is to give up and hope the emperor sees the humor in the whole situation. At some point they both have to be wondering where the fuck the guards are. Like, no shit, the assassin was spared. The emperor was probably too busy purging the entire royal guard. Meanwhile, the emperor is sitting quietly on the top of the pillar, eating ramen and watching the assassin running around and around chasing the tail end of his own cloak. He actually didn't get away. Jing, the assassin, failed in the attempt. The emperor ran around the pillar until he had an opportunity to draw his sword out of his extraordinarily large and unpractical robes to then injure the leg of Jing. After this, the emperor got enough distance to Jing so that the guards could imprison him. There was a no weapon near the emperor policy, so the guards didn't dare to come closer to rescue. Hi, monsieur. Edit. Thanks for this correction. Apparently there wasn't a 2-hour chase around a pillar. I am yet to find out what was instead. Also, we gotta bear in mind this was 200 BC. The sources are probably a little blurry when it comes to accuracy, although Wikipedia does seemingly look quite detailed on this topic. At one time there was not only a pope and an anti-pope, but also a counter-anti-pope. There still is an anti-pope in a sense today. The Palmarian Catholic Church split from the main one in the 70s and claim their pope is the real pope. They also see Hitler as a saint, so they are not the most sane bunch. They asterisk what asterisk split from the main church. If a pope and anti-pope meet, do they annihilate each other? That's why there's a counter-anti-pope. At U.S. President Andrew Jackson's funeral in 1845, his pet parrot had to be removed because it was swearing. Colombia has a period in history literally called the Dumb Homeland period because of how incredibly dumb politicians acted at the time. How long ago? 180 years more or less. But yes, some say it never stopped. When the Netherlands was occupied by RHE Nazis in 1940, many people fled to Canada, including Princess Juliana of the Netherlands and her husband Prince Bernhard of Lippe-Biesterfeld. Their daughter, Princess Margriet, was born in Ottawa, not knowing if the baby would be male, and hence the heir to the throne. Canada declared the maternity ward of the Ottawa Hospital extraterritorial, which means it became international territory. This meant that the baby would derive its nationality only from its mother, making it 100% Dutch. That's why the Netherlands send tons and tons of tulip bulbs to Canada every year. They're planted all around the city of Ottawa, and in the spring the city celebrates the tulip festival. There are tulips of all kinds and colors all over the place. We've also named an entire hospital in Toronto after the Princess Tilda. Edit. I am wrong. I'm writing a paper on this for uni right now. The Dutch still send thousands of tulip bulbs to Ottawa as a thank you every year, and as a result Ottawa has its own tulip festival. The shortest war occurred between Zanzibar and the British Empire, lasting around 45 minutes. Both the British and the Zanzibar Sultanate fielded a couple thousand men with a few boats. However, the war ended with a single Brit wounded. Meanwhile, the Zanzibarians suffered approximately 500 dead or wounded, including civilians, and their entire navy, a yacht, two boats and a shore battery, gone. What? That is some serious superior firepower there. Basically, the British had multiple ironclad gunships with heavy, for 1896, artillery and just bombarded the Sultan's building in the Zanzibar Navy for 38 minutes. During the most critical portion of World War II, the Japanese thought they had sunk or disabled three American carriers when, in reality, they had only bombed the USS Yorktown three times. They were caught with their pants down when the bombs started landing at Midway. The documentary The Greatest Events of World War II in Color has a very nice episode about the Battle of Midway. Highly recommendable. Edit. It's on Netflix. Edit 2. Purple Sailor pointed the real name of the documentary out. During WW2, a bunch of German soldiers got separated in rural Russia. They were trudging through snow with no food or water for days before finally finding a supply drop that missed its mark. They opened it up and found only black pepper and condoms. Edit. For anyone wondering, my source for this is Storm of War by Andrew Roberts. Unfortunately, I can't remember the page number because I read the book a few years ago, but I believe the chapter is called Clash of the Titans. I'm sorry, I don't have a more exact source, but I'm a random commenter, not a history teacher. Well, the pepper will temporarily make us feel warm, and is for the condoms. When in Rome, using the condoms will also make us feel warm. Montenegro technically was in war with Japan for 101 years, and they signed a peace treaty in 2006. Montenegro was allied with Russia in Russo-Japanese War, and they declared war on Japan, but they forgot to peace. There used to be bread stamps burned into a cooked loaf of bread to avoid bread fraud, as the government supplied the wheat flour. But some bakers tried to use sawdust and other ingredients in the bread to make the wheat last longer. The bread stamps were baker-specific, so they could track down where any tainted bread came from. Monsieur, if they were caught, they had to move to another town to make bread, or wait 3 years to continue making bread, if I remember correctly. Bread laws were huge throughout most of history. Nowadays, the idea of the government so strictly regulating an industry that they are forced to sell at a certain price seems odd. But in a time when food shortages were always a danger and food reserves were slim, bread becomes a very important commodity. It's how the Roman emperors kept Rome quiet despite the fact it was such an absurdly huge city. Literally, bread and circuses. Free bread, free water, and free entertainment. As St. Lawrence was roasted to death on a gridiron, he is said to have remarked to his torturers, "I am cooked on this side. Turn me over." St. Lawrence is the patron saint of cooks and comedians. Thomas Jefferson and John Adams died on the same day, July 4, 1826, the 50th anniversary of them both signing the Declaration of Independence. Adams's last words were, "Thomas Jefferson survives. He was wrong by about 5 hours." The longest ever U.S. presidential inauguration speech was made by William Henry Harrison on March 4, 1841. The day had terrible weather, yet Harrison chose to deliver his speech nonetheless, running 8,445 words. In fact, the speech was so long, and the weather so terrible, that Harrison caught pneumonia and died on April 4, making him the shortest reigning U.S. president ever. And his relatives are pawnshop owners on the History Channel. General Omar Bradley was stopped by MP during the Battle of the Bulge in WW2 due to them thinking he was a Nazi infiltrator. The irony was that he was stopped because he correctly identified the capital of Illinois as Springfield when the officer thought it was Chicago. I've met plenty of people who thought Chicago was the capital of Illinois just because it's our most populated city. Ancient Greek and Roman marble statues were actually originally painted and were colorful. A lot of the statues' paint faded away and went away over time. Some people cleaned off the paint thinking it was debris or dirt, and other people just plain cleaned and removed all of the paint off of them because they preferred the look of white marble. Rome was actually a very colorful city and it wasn't all made of just boring plain white marble. I'm taking a course in classical archaeology and it's almost painful to sit through the my professor discuss what the early archaeologists did. How about that paleontologist who blew up an entire dig site just to prevent his rival from excavating it? You talking about the dinosaur bone wars? I listened to a podcast about that pretty wild story. I need to know more about this. Thank you so much for watching and have a good day.